Here, listen to this, out of one of them army pamphlets. To a young man, soldiering in the army of today offers exceptional advantages and opportunities, such as physical training, foreign travel, sport, and many other facilities which are normally denied to those engaged in the majority of civilian occupations. The majority of occupations in civil life become monotonous, to say the least. But in the army, life is so varied that there is little or no prospect of a monotonous or irksome time.
So men were girded for their highest hour. And while they learned the lethal arts of war, in small and secret rooms, the planners met to watch their work mature. Beyond our view, the German, proud and confident, stood calm in deep emplacements on the armored coast. The war was not yet one of men and blood. The weapons were the factories and the maps and voices speaking in the hidden night. Season by season, all our plans advanced, and those few men on whom the mass of war rested with all its weight worked ceaselessly.
I used to wonder whether the millions of people doing their various jobs realized they were part of it all, paving the way for the invasion.
We kept bashing away at German targets, mostly steel and oil, the Ruhr, Hamburg, Battle of Berlin.
Things were getting tougher every trip. More ground defenses, more night fighters, more crews not coming back.
We got away early in the morning. Sometimes we'd see Lancasters coming back. A lot of times we'd stoke up the same targets they did. We beat up aircraft factories too. It was a deluxe service, day and night, 24 hours a day.
We dropped agents over France. Must be awful to risk your neck and have to keep it secret.
One-man submarines, torpedo boats, commandos. We used them all to bring back cups full of sand from the beaches for analysis.
It had to be quick drying with a solid clay foundation. It would have to support 30-ton tanks.
I must have photographed nearly every field in France. Real job, of course, was the Caen area, but I didn't know that, nor did Jerry.
We dropped stuff to the Mackie, arms, ammunition, sabotage materials, and so on. Then went over ourselves and taught them how to use it.
We built it to specification, but we hadn't the least idea what kind of a gadget it was. The only name it had was Mulberry.
It was vital to know all about the Seine Bay and the tides.
And we trained the men to negotiate those tides in landing craft.
Wearing down German sea power in preparation for the day.
A special study of the weather along the Normandy coast.
Miles of wire netting for the beaches. 7,200 tons of petrol per day.
With an underwater pipeline to carry it to France.
A white star is the emblem of liberation.
Triple inoculation for all personnel.
New ships pouring from the stocks. Old ships adapted.
Listening to the German radio output for fresh intelligence.
That was just part of the pre-invasion work. By December 43, the plan itself was set and we took it to Tehran for final discussion.
The three leaders approved the plan. Our Russian forces advancing from the east and invasion from the west. And then the date was set.
I assumed command at SHAEF with the best all-around team for which a man could ask. Some had already been working for months in England. Others I brought with me from the Mediterranean. We adopted first a master plan, and then had to coordinate every last detail of the ground, sea, and air plans. While this was going on, we led off with an air show designed to make the landing points as soft as possible, to batter the German communications, and to make certain we'd have control of the air. It was quite a show. Those airmen did a magnificent job.
We had Polish, French, Czechs, all sorts in our outfit. They'd natter away in the mess about what they'd been up to. The only word you could ever make out was marshalling yards.
Us bombardiers seemed to do nothing but look down on French bridges those days. We used to ask each other, have you cut any good bridges lately? Well, finally, there was only one whole railway bridge left over the Seine between Paris and the sea.
Down in the late spring, through the wounded towns of England, moved the mass made by our patients. Two precious years of plans were put away. The offices were empty. All the maps were rolled up on the walls. What had been paper at last had come alive. Across the channel, aware of our resolve, with cold contempt, alerted Germans stood beside their guns, and reinforcements rumbled from the Rhine. Their generals were prepared, their might was poised. They looked across the heaving sea and grinned. They would reap harvest of us on the beaches, and even death himself would stand amazed. Yet faint across the groaning of the sea came the thin thunder of a mass of power. Drawn from the great free peoples of the earth, it gathered in the ancient ports of England to crowd upon the steel-encumbered ships.
Sort of feeling marching down to the ships. We'd done it plenty of times before, of course, on schemes and that kind of thing. They didn't tell us this was the big show. Might have been just another exercise. Some of the chaps cracked gags. They wasn't very comic, but we laughed. I think we all guessed. The general feeling was, okay, if this is it, let's get in there and get it over with. Waiting always got on my nerves. Even waiting for a bus, never could stand it. Well, after a bit, our ship found its place in the middle of all the rest of the stuff. And there we stayed. For days.
They gave us the final briefing then. We knew what to do and how. They told us where and when. That's a briefing. I listened every word. Wrote it down in my head like a record, and it kept playing over and over again. Piece of beach in the morning. Ever since I became a soldier, they were getting me ready for this. Before, there'd been time in front of me, protecting me. Now the time had worn away, and there were only a few hours left. In the morning, I'd have to face it. I tried to imagine how much fear I would have, you know, if it would keep me from doing my job. I suppose everybody else was wondering the same thing.
Nobody said anything official, but all of a sudden the ship got much busier. And over the amplifier, the chaplain said he'd be saying mass at 18:30 hours. Funny, I don't think I ever believed, even after the final briefing, that the invasion was going to come off. Then a voice in the loudspeaker said, "Men who wish to take their anti-seasick pills should take the first one now." That did it.